Hi, I'm Matt Lieb.
And I'm Vince Mancini.
And this is
Pod Yourself a gun.
Jesus Christ, Vince. A Sopranos podcast where Vince Mancini and I go through every single episode of The Sopranos and talk about it. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh, it's very, it's a very good podcast. No one ever says that before their podcast starts. We talk about, you know, not just like the show in general, but we like to talk about what's going on at the time the show was filmed, that the time it was released, how very 90s it is. I mean, we really get into it. We're also the world's only Sopranos podcast, so if you happen to be someone who listens to something else and you're like, oh, but I've listened to these other Sopranos podcasts, those aren't real. Don't listen to those. Because those, you know, they take it too seriously. Isn't that right, Vince?
Listen to all those. Just make sure you listen to this one. They're our friends. They're our buddies.
Damn it.
Honestly, look, I was trying to get Vincent Pastor to come on to do an interview with us, but then he said...
Yeah, big pussy.
Yeah, he said he wouldn't do it because he was loyal to one of these other Sopranos podcasts
with Michael members
that don't exist. Yeah. And I was like, there's a lot of fish in the ocean. There's water for all of the fish. I don't know what this metaphor means. But there's a lot of podcasts. You can listen to them all. Doesn't feel like a feud. We started ours first, but that's fine.
I know. I do wish that, his people had really conveyed the message that although Michael Imperioli and Steve Sharipa do a Sopranos rewatch podcast, they don't really do what we do. Mm-hmm. And what we do is simple. We watch Sopranos. We talk about how it's a show about titties and meat. And then we do cool remixes of different clips.
Yeah.
And that's a different type of podcast.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. All right. So our guest today is a TV writer and the co-host of the Sexy Unique podcast, Carey O'Donnell. How you doing, Carey?
Hey, guys. I'm good. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. So you are a Sopranos fan?
I am. Well, I'm from Jersey, too. So I feel like I was kind of coming of age in the age of Sopranos in New Jersey.
Where in New Jersey?
I'm from South. I'm more near Philly, so I'm not like in true Sopranos land. But
right.
There's a lot of that going on where I'm from too. So I used to watch. I would like watch with my parents on Sunday nights, and I would like, sometimes I wouldn't watch, but I would like peer around and see if there was stuff in it. And so I was, I was like in elementary school, middle school when it was first coming in.
Oh, so you're. Is it what man. Exit a thing you ask when you're from Jersey?
Yeah.
So do they go? So, do they go up in number as you get further north, or vice versa?
I think vice versa. I haven't lived in Jersey for a few years, so I'm a little rusty. But yeah, it's the Jersey Turnpike and the Garden State Parkway are sort of the dominant routes. Mm-hmm. Where everything is, everything takes place on either one of those. So,
have you ever been to that Jersey Shore they got?
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Really, we used to have a beach house in Ocean City near Atlantic City.
Nice.
And I lived like 40 minutes away from the Pine Barrens, which I know is like a important episode,
classic episode, or so we hope.
Yeah. So I know I'm familiar with all that, the weirdness of it, and.
Nice.
I think the show really taps into that nicely.
So when people say what exit, like, do you say a number or do you say the street?
I mean, I was off 295, so my exit was like the Cherry Hill.
I mean, you said a number, so.
Yeah, 295.
But that's not an exit number. That was a highway number. And he said a name for the. Anyways, we know a lot about New Jersey on this podcast.
It's important information.
You know more about exits than I do, maybe. Maybe I need to hang up my jersey.
Nah.
All I know is I saw a shirt once that had an outline of New Jersey on it, and then the caption was "What exit?" So, like,
you're correct.
That's all I know. That's the extent of my knowledge.
It's all based on a shirt that you saw.
Yeah.
Well, anything I know about New Jersey comes from my dad, who grew up in Newark.
Oh.
And so all I know about New Jersey is like, now the neighborhood's mostly black.
Yeah.
That's all I know. I literally, like, and he says black with a hard B. He's a weird guy. That's all I know about Jersey. He's like, it used to be a Jewish neighborhood. And I was like, all right.
Yeah, I feel like Jersey has a sordid past in many respects.
I'm sure it has a sordid present.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think Jersey, I love Jersey, and especially, like, I was in New York for 5 years, so, like, everyone was from New Jersey, I feel like, but
yeah,
come to LA, it's rarer, and I always feel excited when someone is from, even more specific from my area, but even if they're just from New Jersey, I get excited, and I feel like we have, like, a false, like, intimacy immediately that we're, like, we get each other, but, like, we don't at all, but we're...
Yeah.
I choose to believe the ruse, you know?
It feels in some ways like a funhouse mirror version of like Southern California. Like the culture, a lot of the things are the same. It's like highway culture and like mall culture and sort of that, that like same mass market, like cheesiness, but then with different, the people look different, like with like a different, ethnic breakdown, I guess.
No, I feel like I've actually thought that too. I've never heard someone describe it as accurately as you just did, but
nice.
No, it is very like highways and like strip malls and mall culture is kind of big here. So I think and especially down towards like Orange County, like a lot of that reminds me of South Jersey.
It's just one giant mall.
Yeah, guys got an Orange County. Southern California's got an Orange County.
Oh,
yeah.
Shit. There you go. Good point.
Yeah.
Wow.
Damn, dude. You actually know a lot more about New Jersey than you've ever let on in this podcast.
That was it. That was all of it.
Yeah. Wow. Those are good factoids though. I just Googled my exit. I'm exit 32.
Oh, there we go.
Nice. So it is numbers.
Yeah, you were right.
Well, there we go. Speaking of numbers, that's a transition. Today we're gonna talk about the number 3 episode of season 3 of The Sopranos, and it's called Fortunate Son. But before we get into that, it is time for Vince to play the intro. Pod. Yourself again. Your mama always said you'd be there. Chosen. Pod. Pod. You got to burn the shine. You were born under a podcast. Blue moon in your eyes. Pod. 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 Podcast. It's funny every time. All right.
Yeah. Do any of the other Sopranos podcasts have that? I don't think so.
Also, if they did, they probably legally have the rights to play the music.
Parody.
Which we don't.
It's fair use.
Which is why it's parody.
Fair use.
Yep. Fair use. We don't need a license. So today's episode premiered March 11th, 2001. Once again, it's called Fortunate Son, Season 3, Episode 3. So, Vince, what was going on during the time of this
episode's release? Oh, you mean
we're
taking the Remember When machine? Walk, walk, daddy, daddy, bop, bop, shoo, bop. Remember
then. Remember when. Remember when is the lowest form of conversation.
Boom. 2 for 2 on just amazing stings.
Yeah. March 11th, 2001, just to put this into cultural context, some of the headlines that were going around that day were in the New York Post, unmatched success. Rob Thomas sounds off on hitting it big.
Wow.
That is.
Whoa.
That is, of course, about Rob Thomas, the lead singer of Matchbox 20.
And this is 2001.
Yeah. Well, 2 years earlier, he came out with Smooth, which, if anything, has aged like a fine wine.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. Smooth gets better and better every time I hear it. But I mean, because Matchbox 20 is I would describe as firmly 90s music.
Yeah.
But in 2001, March 11th, their PR guy reached out to the New York Post and they're like, "We need another article." ASAP.
I think Rob Thomas and Santana are timeless, but sure. You know, I respect that assertion. Some of the other headlines, Russia tells of major loss in Chechnya from the LA Times.
Sad.
Yeah, the war that of course brought us Vladimir Putin. California jobless rate lowest in 30 years.
Well, I'm sure it'll stay low.
Yeah, nothing bad will happen.
Nothing bad ever happened in 2001.
I know, pre-9/11, Rob Thomas is like throwing me right now.
Yeah, I know. It's wild because you really do realize that...
he had a V-neck, you know, and a metal shiny necklace.
Uh-huh. The 90s did not end officially until September 11th, 2001. And so, like, they still got, you know, we're talking about fucking Matchbox 20 and Rob Thomas and Tana. I mean, shit is looking good.
I also feel like the New York Post was like, seems like they were hurting for news that year. So,
oh my God. Yes. Yeah.
Remember slow news days? God, those were good.
Those ruled.
Just wait, you know?
Yeah. The top movies were The Mexican, starring Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston. 15 Minutes, starring Robert De Niro and Ed Burns, which is a movie that I did not remember at all. And holdover from last week, Sea Spot Run, starring David Arquette and a dog.
Right. It's about a dog that goes into witness protection. And we got an email from a listener who reminded us that Steve Sharipa is in it. Bobby Bacala. Mm-hmm. Isn't that Bobby Bacala? It plays a mafioso trying to kill the dog in Sea Spot Run.
Yeah.
So,
well, you see what Sopranos did for his career. And the top songs, holdovers from last week. Stutter by Joe featuring Mystical. Drive by Incubus.
Still topping the charts.
Still topping the charts. And that was the Wayback Machine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So,
yes. I think James Gandolfini was in The Mexican.
Yeah, I think he was the Mexican. I don't remember exactly, but he was the he was the head guy.
Particular role.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Well, you know, I hate to do this, but James Gandolfini's canceled. I got to do it, you know? Uh-huh. He's taking roles from Mexicans.
Done.
It's
he's done.
It's too bad. All right, so let's get into this.
We could have had Carlos Mencia playing the Mexican.
Yeah, yeah. He didn't get big till a few years later.
He was very much a post 9/11 phenomenon.
Oh, very post 9/11.
Yeah,
yeah. So the episode is called "Fortunate Son," and let me just break down the Butterbee stories. All right, here we go. Chris gets made. Paulie gets paid. AJ is afraid. Janice steals leg. Jackie Jr. dresses like Blade. Meadow throws shade. And Tony stayed while Satriali's finger got flayed, which left him dismayed and needing first aid. How about that?
Yeah, good job. Great.
Thank
great
you.
Work. Great work. I mean, we could just describe the plot. You know, like normal speech. But
let's do it.
What's... I like your rhyming stuff, too.
I like that.
Vince, give us a brief synopsis of the episode.
You want the actual written one?
Yeah.
Christopher finds that being a made man isn't all it's cracked up to be. Meanwhile, Janice moves into her mother's house, where she soon gets a leg up on Livia's former housekeeper.
God. HBO Max's descriptions of episodes are getting more and more cheeky, and I do not like it.
No. So we start out, Christopher's getting made, which it's sort of anticlimactic in this version of it, because I feel like we're coming off Goodfellas, where like they find out Joe Pesci's about to get made, and it's a huge deal. And, you know, he kisses his mother, and he dresses in a nice suit, and then he walks in the room and realizes he's getting whacked, and then Robert De Niro kicks down the payphone booth.
The phone booth.
But in this, is, you know, it's just some guys, they meet in a parking lot in Jersey, and then they go hang out at a house. And he sees
a crow.
And
then they go to a strip club.
He sees a crow. Well, they don't go to a strip club. They basically stay in like a strip mall meeting room. Like, what was the venue for that? I like.
You mean during the making?
No, making happened to look like in some sort of basement club. They hang out in a lot of clubhouses. I feel like the mafia is just a series of man caves that they go to.
Yeah.
An Elks Club or something.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it really is the Elks Club. And then Christopher gets made, which is interrupted by a crow on the windowsill, which is like my favorite. One of my favorite like recurring motifs in The Sopranos is just like everyone wondering how superstitious they should be now.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Everyone also has a specific fear of animals and symbolism with those animals. Like, and you're not even. What's that?
I love crows. So I was very excited.
If you got made, you saw the crow, you'd be like, "Aw." Yeah, I loved that he was freaked out by it. And I was surprised to see that this wasn't just like kind of like a made up omen, that apparently there is some sort of lore behind a bird in the house is being bad luck or something like that. And actually, I have a clip of that.
It was that bird. It was that fucking bird in a window.
It was a coincidence.
I was making good jack at that betting parlor. I was in the fucking zone. Now everything turns to shit.
The bird thing is if it's in the house, flapping around. And that's death, not bad luck.
Will your mother loan me the money?
She's still paying for a hysterectomy.
It's that fucking tennis bracelet I got you.
Why don't you get rid of that stupid fucking Range Rover, which you shouldn't have even bought if you couldn't afford it? Ow!
Yeah, they packed in a lot of information. A lot of world building was done in that scene alone. I mean, number one, you find out that a bird in the house is actually, you know, some sort
it's worth two in the betting parlor.
It's worth, worth two in the betting parlor. Right.
Sicilians are the most superstitious motherfuckers on earth. Like, I'm sure you could find some sort of like Sicilian superstition for just about anything.
The podcast I do, we recap old reality shows, and we did season two of New Jersey Housewives, which is very like mob adjacent feeling.
Yeah.
And we were confused on why someone was wearing the Italian horn and on like a necklace, and we got a flood of Italian Americans being like, you don't know anything. Like, it's about it warped off evil spirits, like the evil eye, and like all that, like, they allude to witchcraft in the show. So they are, and I think some of them are from Sicily, so they're very like hardcore about it.
Yeah, it's weird because it's like I understand like superstitions derived from like hardcore Catholicism, because you know, at some point, if you start really believing in Catholicism or any religion, sure, it's all superstition in some way. What's weird is that like Sicilians and Italians in general seem to have very specific
This is all pre-Catholicism. This is like this is like pagan shit. Well, I mean, Catholicism was smart. They're like, oh, you guys got a tree, well, the tree that you dance around, that stands for Jesus's birthday now. So it's
right,
kinda,
yeah.
Like
yeah.
They co-opted all the old pagan shit.
Yeah, they were good at incorporating it all into the religion.
But so he sees the crow, and I don't know. Their weird superstitious stuff is some of my favorite stuff in The Sopranos, and it goes to like one of my favorite shots in the finale, which we'll get to later. But so
you're talking about the cat.
The cat, yeah.
Yeah, Polly has a thing with a cat. Chrissy has a thing with a crow. Tony has a thing with ducks
and horses.
Horses. Like, there's a lot of animal superstition in this. Yeah. And
I also love how Christopher just then decides to blame a woman.
Right.
Yeah. So then they go from him getting made to like this incredibly well lit, like, I don't know, banquet space in like a mall somewhere. And I love that there's just these strippers that are dancing while they're like sitting around a fully lit banquet space.
So they weren't in the Bing. They were in just a banquet space with strippers.
Yes.
Yeah. I also always forget like the scenes when in the strip club, like the music that's always playing is like always really like awesome. And like not like for a show about mobsters, like the music's almost like a music that you would hear at like a gay club.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like it's like they're playing that song, a remix of like I See You Baby
Shaking That Ass. Yeah.
Like, I don't know. That's just like that's such a great like house music. I don't know. You know what I mean? It's like almost, doesn't almost match up with the
Especially since like as soon as you take your eyes off the strippers, you're just kinda hanging out with your boys. Listening to I See You Baby Shaking That Ass, and you're right, it does have like this off feel to it.
I think that's a situation that's like one of the few situations where they just let the strippers pick the music, and so they're kind of like, okay, this is what they like to dance to. Okay.
Hey, whatever floats the boat, you know. I do feel like if they chose the music, it would be a mixture of like 70s rock songs. And just random 50s Italian crooners who I'm sure are incredibly hard to pole dance.
They'd be
to.
Like trying to pole dance to Louis Prima and shit.
Yeah. Mario Lasagna is just singing.
So Chrissy, like the plot point here is that Chris takes over Polly's sports book, which at the time he thinks is like this big honor. So
yeah,
like one of the major questions I have about this episode is like, is he taking the bets or making the bets? Because like when you take a bet, your entire goal is to set the line so that the bets are even on both sides. Like you kind of don't really, like if you're the sports book, all you care about is setting the line and hopefully it makes it, hopefully the line is in such a place that the bets are even on both sides. And then they basically all pay out and then you take a cut, like 10% of each bet, and then you make money either way. But in this, it makes it seem like Chris is actually like placing bets himself and losing.
I was completely confused about the whole thing. I don't know how betting works at all. Like you're talking about the line, I'm lost already. I know there's a spread. I've heard of a thing.
The way it
spread.
Works is, you know, Denver's playing the Lakers, and like I set the line at whatever. Like if people think the Lakers are going to win, I say the Lakers, you know, -6, which means the Lakers have to win the game by 6 points. Hopefully that will make it so the same amount of people bet on the Lakers and the Nuggets. That way I don't lose money paying them out. Like the goal is to have it even on both sides. And then,
so he's losing money paying people out. That's what it sounds like.
It sounds like he's betting on specific teams himself, which I found slightly confusing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how betting works. I don't bet.
I just told you.
Yeah, I still don't get it. I kind of phase out. I have the same thing with like tabletop card games. Like someone tried to teach me Magic the Gathering, and I was just like, I can't. I can't do it.
The minute like betting and like, I didn't even know if they were betting on football. I was just like,
well.
I just like assumed.
Incorrect. Yeah. So before we go on, I just want to say did you feel that this was, I felt like this was a very standard episode of The Sopranos in general. Like this felt
I thought it was pretty fantastic.
No, it was good, but it felt like Sopranos default setting. Like we've had like two seasons of them kind of getting their shit together, right? In terms of like how the Sopranos works. And this one felt like the most, like they had
everything that I like about The Sopranos. They had some fainting, they had some therapy, they had some family shit, they had some gangster shit, and it all leads to Chris robbing a Jewel concert. Like, that's like everything I love about The Sopranos.
Like, but you're talking, like, this is standard Sopranos golden age. Right. This is default good Soprano. Like, there was much worse episodes. Like, the default in seasons 1 and 2 was not nearly as good as this episode, I think.
Yeah, no, exactly. But, like, this is the point at which I think I started watching The Sopranos and having this as the expectation, pretty much. And like, most episodes matched it.
Yeah, it comes to a consistent level of excellence by this point, I think.
Right.
I also thought it was, like, the real crux of the episode about, like, father relationship, like the trauma that your father like foisted upon you is kind of like the center of the whole show. Like, it really is in many ways, like Tony and his trauma, and like like literally meat cause, you know, we'll get to that, but like something as small as that, it's like this hyper masculine thing of like grilling, and you know what I mean, and like,
and then also
they're also they're also all trying to prepare their children to be part of like the American upper class, which they have no idea how to do themselves. So like they don't like, he doesn't know how to train Jackie Jr. or AJ how to be like doctors and lawyers and stuff. It's like he's telling them that he doesn't want them to go in his footsteps, but he has no idea how what that next step looks like.
Right, they only know it's college. That's all they know.
Was kind of how it was when we went. Like, I feel like when we were growing up, it was just like, oh yeah, you go to college, and then after that, you're you know,
it all works out. Yeah, that's the secret is college. That's, you know, the reason that I'm a gangster today is because I never went to college, and it's like, no, it has more to do with the trauma.
Yeah, I also think it's really, I mean, and just like the inherited trauma of like. Like AJ, kind of the cycles of like a child just repeating what their parent does.
And yeah.
Also for me, like Carmela is my favorite. Oh, and
yes.
So good.
Really
the best.
You really see like her complicitness and or just her, like that she's kind of rotten in a way. At the end when Meadow is, when she's like, does your friend know, like don't air our family, but you know what I mean? And like you kind of see her, like she's part of,
I mean, she's locked into this life.
I mean,
and
that I think yes, but I also like that I saw her as being like a much more like effective like parent and manipulator than Tony is, where because like, Tony just like reacts to things like, oh, you're dating a black, and then he gets pissed, whereas like Carmela
doesn't like it either.
She doesn't,
but she has.
But she knows that she knows that she knows. She can't go in through the front door. She's got to, know, wait for it to blow over. Which, you know,
right? She's as racist, but or at least like similarly racist to Tony in terms of like a traditional, AKA racist, wish that she date within her race, basically. But she also is, she's more cunning. She knows that, you know, if you make this a thing, she's gonna do it just to spite us, you know. And so she has to be more careful with her her deep desire to be racist.
I also think she's like very insightful of Meadow's like she kind of knows the game that Meadow's trying to play in a way that Tony doesn't, where she's like, because that is true. It's like you were gonna have this out with your father in front of your friend. Like that was that was gonna be really shitty for him. But okay.
Yeah. So the scene we're talking about specifically is the one where Carmela and AJ both visit Meadow in Colombia, and when they arrive, they see Meadow is there with her new boyfriend Noah.
Go Lions.
Yeah. and of course I guess this was a setup a little bit for Tony to show up with them and have it out with Noah, which is to me a very confusing, like I think it was she wanted to subject, she was okay with subjecting Noah to more abuse if it meant that she could see it for herself. Like, she wanted to see and have, like, visual proof.
She wanted the attention
of Tony's
She's an annoying
racism.
College freshman.
She is, and she did want to be sanctimonious in front of him, and yeah. And she doesn't disappoint. I have a clip from that, Vince. It's called Noah.
Noah told me what Dad said to him. It's all out in the open, so fuck this.
Let's watch the latrine lip.
Oh, what'd Dad say?
Anthony, would you go downstairs and wait for me? I would like to talk to your sister.
Oh, I know what he said.
Go.
I'm always being sent to him. Why do I bother going in?
What did your father say?
Like he didn't tell you, please.
Well, believe what you
like. He called Noah things that are so disgusting and ugly, I can't even repeat it.
You are right. There is no excuse.
Just lucky I didn't punch his fucking lights out.
Because you're a civilized person.
But you wanted your father to come here for what? To subject your friend to this again?
Oh, wait. So I'm in the wrong. The rest of the world should work around his racist, retrograde, fucking asshole personality.
I mean, the beauty of this is like classic Sopranos where there are no good guys.
Yeah, yeah. First of all... Noah saying he's lucky I didn't punch his fucking lights out is weirdly, it's so relatable to me.
Yeah, it's such a good college freshman thing to say too.
Yeah, it's like, ooh, yeah. Dude, if he had said it to me one more time, I swear to God, yeah. Dude. Ooh, yeah. I swear
oh, if
to
my
God.
Friends hadn't been there holding me back, dude. Ooh, oh,
you're lucky I respect your daughter so much. Like...
And then Meadow being like, that's because you're a good person.
Yeah, that's the reason why he didn't immediately try to fight the mob man.
Yeah,
it was just like, it's this great kind of like, I mean, you know, Noah's, he's an 18-year-old kid, you know, he's trying to be an adult. And, you know, so, you know, he says at one point, I'm not going anywhere unless Meadow wants me to. Which is like, you know, it's cute and, you know, it's almost like when you're, I feel like when you're 18 and you're away for college, you are super cosplaying adult relationships.
Yes.
In this way where like even real life, you know, serious interactions are kind of like theater, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're like in a Felicity episode.
Yeah, exactly.
And not only that, like her parents sent her to college specifically so that she would like outgrow them in terms of like, you know, wokeness and being an intellectual.
Right.
And so right. Like she's cosplaying that.
She's, yeah. And
I love when he later when she's like, we're going out of town this weekend to Connecticut, I think.
Yeah,
she's
right.
Like, his friends who work in Hollywood.
Yeah. They work at NBC. So
they work at NBC.
Yeah, yeah. It's this weird kind of like, and she starts the sentence, if you must know, which I got to say is something that only people who want to sound smart say. Well, yeah. If you must know, me and...
Yeah, she's also trying to like shame her mom for being like...
Yeah.
Like our family is like so provincial and like, yes. You know what I mean? And so she's, there's a lot of, and I think Carmela... And her have that dynamic a lot about
oh yeah
like, shaming her for being like a housewife, you know.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Shaming Carmela for her retrograde lifestyle, which is just it's a super super mean thing to do to your mom, especially since she raised you. But at the same time, you know, that's
but again, kinda, that's what they sent her to college to do is to
that, exactly that's yeah. What you learn in college. You know, you learn how to. Pretend you're better than people and hate your parents. So that's basically one of the things that Tony is dealing
yeah,
with.
Yeah, that's the Meadow Carmela storyline. And and then there's my
and then we,
favorite storyline.
Oh, what's your favorite?
Janice.
Oh, yes.
I mean, we've all known a Janice and God, it's just so perfect. This whole, the entire storyline.
She's like that Flannery O'Connor short story.
Yeah.
Which one? I don't know anything.
The one where the woman has one. She's a wooden leg, and the traveling salesman like swipes her leg.
Oh, I don't know that one. But
barn. Yeah,
that does sound amazing. Yeah. I mean, every season, or I guess it's like every episode that has a little bit of Janice at this point, I just get excited. Because
but this I feel like this is the peak Janice episode. No,
she just keeps getting better. Yeah. I mean, so far this is her peak. So basically we're back to last week's episode, where Janice is obsessed with getting these musical theater records back from Svetlana, mm-hmm. the one-legged caretaker, who was she got those records gifted to her by Livia before Livia passed, and she is not willing to give them back. Now you'd think that you'd leave that storyline alone, like that would just be a little bit of flair, bit of comedy for last week's episode.
That if you've ever known an Italian family, you would know you would never leave that storyline alone, and it would come back many times over and over.
So she. Janice moves back into Livia's house. Tony allows it, and Svetlana has basically found another place to stay, and they spend one night together. Svetlana stays in Janice's old room while Janice tries to convince her, like, if you could please just consider giving me those records back. Then she wakes up the next day, and her leg is gone. Janice has stolen her leg. And
Janice briefly is trying like the good cop act, and because what's her face is Russian. She's like, "Oh no, I'm not buying this for a second."
She's it cuts through all of Janice's bullshit, which is I think a reason that Janice hates her so much.
Yes.
I think it's the fact that she is so blunt. You can't really manipulate Svetlana. Yeah.
You get some of the best, like, that slut Sal stole my leg. and then she says, like, this C word's going to be sorry she ever fucked with me. Like, she has some good zingers.
Oh, yeah. It is great. And
everything Svetlana says, even when she just tells Tony, she's like, there's two Miller genuines in the fridge. And it's like, oh,
yeah.
Like the way she says, Miller genuine.
Yeah, she's got a great accent, and so at this point, this has become such a recurring thing with Janice, where she is basically the godfather of pettiness, that I think it's going to be a recurring clip segment on the show called Janice Petty Godfather.
Oh, don't give me bullshit. Where is my leg?
Your leg? Oh, yeah. Where's your...
I know you took it.
That's preposterous. I mean, what possible use would I have for your leg?
Because you think that will make me give records back.
If you see some karmic connection between your taking my mother's records and the disappearance of your leg, wow. The records return to the rightful owner, and so does the leg. I can see how you got there.
I don't know how you can live with yourself.
This cunt is gonna be sorry she ever fuck with me.
Well, you better hope you have all your shit out of here, cause I'm calling the locksmith.
You did a lot of audio editing once again.
Yep. That was a Godfather theme played by a bad recorder. I do love the toughness of Janice when she says, you better have all your stuff out of here because I'm calling a locksmith. Like, I'm changing the locks. She is a petty, cowardly gangster, and it's just so much fun to watch.
But also, like, a woman that I would probably, that would, like, teach Sunday school.
Oh, 100%.
Like, I would it's so true.
Taught by her, my local parish, and, like, I just saw that when I was watching her.
Yeah,
I
mean, it's that fake enlightened hippie woman where she, is teaching everybody important lessons about psychology, but while being the most petty human, manipulative human being alive.
Yeah, I mean, everything she does is a grift, which is the exact same thing as anyone in the mafia. Everything that anyone does in the mafia is a grift of one form or another. It's just Janice's grifts are they're more petty, and they also have no return on investment, really.
No.
Like, they're all just the worst get-rich-quick schemes.
She just feels entitled to her mom's records, and she wants them. That's the whole thing, yeah. She wants
Well, she's going to sell them.
Yeah.
She's, like, just as much of a sociopath as Tony.
100%.
Even 100%. I would argue more so.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, she's, like, almost crueler.
Yeah.
Definitely like, crueler.
That's a cruel thing to do to someone, and, like, she's just unabashed about it.
Yeah, it's weird because you this is the first time where, because you really have to think about, like, holy shit, she just stole a woman's whole ass leg. Like, that is incredibly sociopathic. Like, that's something that I would not even consider doing. And it is, it's just amazing because you see Tony as kind of like, he's a murderer. He murders people,
sure,
you know,
sure.
And you go, well, that's the height of sociopathy. But then you see someone stealing someone's legs to get some records back.
Yeah.
And you're like, I think that's worse.
I feel like everybody's got like a crazy aunt or like a, you know, like a sister-in-law or someone who's like a Janice where you just like can't stop telling tales about their absolute petty manipulativeness.
Yes. Everyone has like an aunt like that, or like
a friend,
Munchausen-esque aunt, yeah, or something.
Yes,
crazy shit like that.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. There is like everyone has one Janice in their life, and that Janice, whether they're a family member or someone who you know is just someone who's in the orbit of a friend group, that person brings so many people together to just talk about the crazy mishigas that this person has put you through. I mean, I have a Janice in my life who I think I've talked about this on the show before, but like, I know that someday she's going to convince me to just give her $1,000. and I'm ready for it.
Yeah, you're like, keeping it in the bank just in case.
Yeah, I have it in the bank just in case. It is, you know, my Janice is $1,000, and it's just someday she's going to convince me that she needs it, and she needs it right now. And I'm going to be like, I have it ready for you. There's no way I'll be able to say no, because, you know, she's a Janice.
And I think some of those relatives, like, when they want money like that, like, sometimes they don't even, they just want to be able to do it. They don't even need like a specific reason for $1,000. They just want $1,000.
They're people, I would say, like, they're people for whom like affection is one part suffering. And so like in order for you to in order for them to feel your affection, like, they have to make you suffer in some ways. And then in the act of making you suffer, that's them feeling like acceptance and affection.
Yeah, it's because you've allowed them to make you suffer, and that, I think, is there's power there, but then there's also kind of like, okay, good. It's like that's how I know that you love me, is that I can test you like that, and I can severely hurt you and your self-esteem, and you will not throw me out of your life. It is it's a weird thing.
And I think Tony does that like
constantly.
And this, well, obviously, but like specifically with Dr. Melfi.
Yes.
I think, and as the relationship like kind of intensifies, like he's always doing that with her. Like, he's always kind of belittling her in their sessions in lots of ways, but I think it's cuz he's afraid she's going to leave him.
Yeah. I think you're right, and I think he holds that over her, or it's like the way that he stops himself from being powerless in that situation, where she could at any point just be like, "I'm not seeing you anymore," is he threatens to leave over and over again. Like, every other, you know, episode with Melfi,
he is being like, hey, listen, this is either going to start working or I'm out of here. And he has no real interest in leaving, you know. The only time he ever shows interest, I think the only time he ever did leave, and I'm not sure if this is in later seasons or if this happened last season, is like when he just feels good enough and secure enough in himself. That's when he decides, like, I don't need her anymore. But because he's an incredibly insecure man, he actually needs her most of the time.
Yeah.
So, final plot line, I guess, is, I guess there's two other ones. There's
a few more going
AJ
on.
AJ in the football, you know, making his dad proud for once, which is, kind of fun to watch. And then, Jackie Aprile. We meet Jackie Aprile for the, well, not yeah, for the first tale, time, but we get to know him for the first time.
Yeah, it's a tale of two fail sons, you know, both who are, one who has this inflated view of himself and one who has a deflated view of himself. Like Jackie thinks he's a gangster. Mm-hmm. He shows up to a meeting with Tony in like Matrix attire.
Yeah. Very much.
Like, what time is it? What time it is?
Yeah, it was so great. And you know, ask him, of course, to take the sunglasses off, and he does it like it's a chore.
Yeah.
And I think he's lying to Tony, saying that he would never drop out of school, because at that point, I think he already had dropped out. He deep inside wants to be a gangster. He's incredibly jealous of Chrissy's rise to being a made man.
He's the heir apparent, as
exactly, as he says.
So little trivia on that, on the guy who plays Jackie Jr.
Sure.
Jason Serbone was born in Yonkers, New York. He got his start acting at age 4, appearing on a commercial for Sesame Street. He signed with the Ford Modeling Agency in New York City at age 7.
Oh, boy.
Serbone later appeared in Bon Jovi's Silent Night music video, as well as the title character in Suzanne Vega's video for the song Luca. Anybody who signed with a modeling agency at age 7 has seen some shit.
Oh, my, I can't even imagine.
Lindsay Lohan signed with Ford Models at like 5.
Yeah, you know you got really good parents when that happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those are parents who care about you.
When Jackie Jr. is talking about Rutgers. Yeah. Because it's so, I feel like people don't get that, like, in Jersey, when you're in Jersey, when you go to Rutgers, it's like, it's like almost like an inevitable thing. Mm-hmm. But people, and it's a great university, but in Jersey, I think we just take it for granted because, like, everyone goes there. But like out of state, everyone like reveres Rutgers, and like in Jersey, we're like, oh, it's just Rutgers, but it's like a top tier. It's so weird.
That is strange. I didn't know it was a top tier university, but I kind of assumed so, based on the fact that Jackie Jr. Immediately drops out.
Yeah,
because it's just, you know, he goes there and he is expected to be a good student to study, and he can't. So I assumed it wasn't one of those like kind of a fuck off school, kind of safety school. But yeah, he drops out. Meanwhile, AJ takes that trip to Columbia, and after he's like, you know, sent out of the room, he looks around at like, you know, he sees a bunch of like goth kids like reading, and he sees a Muslim woman in hijab, and is immediately like, these people are way too smart for me.
Yeah.
they're a bunch
great
of
middle
freaks.
School reaction to college.
Yeah. It's unfortunate because it seems like those are the exact images that like drove him away from college. If it had just been like people, like if what he wanted to see, which is a bunch of people skateboarding,
and taking huge like, bong rips and
taking huge
movies.
Bong rips, and then just like a fucking, you know, a Super Smash Brothers tournament, like he would have been like, oh hell yeah, college. Instead, he saw his nightmare of people, you know, being individuals.
And it's like a direct like effect of his parents. Like racism.
Yeah, no, he's straight up.
They're upstairs arguing in Meadow's dorm, and he's outside, and he sees like diversity, and he's like,
"Yeah, right." Is like, I can't. This is too scary. Yeah. This isn't for me. But yeah. So Jackie Jr. Of course puts Chris onto a heist.
What was the other Jackie Jr. S character from like season one? The one they had to whack with the
Matthew Bevilacqua.
Yeah, it's almost the same guy.
It's kind of similar, but kind Matthew Bevilacqua's. I think Matthew Bevilacqua's character didn't really have any real connection.
Sure.
He was kind of a wannabe in a different way, whereas like Jackie Jr. is. You know, is kind of, he's AJ's other, you know what I mean? He's like, he was the son, he was the heir apparent of the New Jersey crime family until his dad passed from cancer. Mm-hmm. So I feel like he has a little bit more, I don't know. There's a little more background to him. There's a little bit more like you kind of, he's not just a buffoon. That was kind of Matthew Bevilacqua's character.
Right. I mean, he is a buffoon.
He is a buffoon, but he's not only a buffoon.
Sure, sure. He's also an asshole
and also the hair apparent. Yes. So he puts Chris onto a heist that he was going to do, what I would call a jewel heist.
Hey.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you.
I didn't even make that connection.
Yeah.
That should have been the name of the episode, Jewel Heist.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually have a few alternate titles real quick. My titles are Jewel Heist, aka These Foolish Games Are Tearing Me Apart.
Oh.
And I also have Made, more like M-A-I-D, but that one wasn't as good.
My title was The Crow, City of Angels.
Oh, that's good. I like. So yeah, Chris hears about, kind of like, something in the vicinity of Jackie Jr. and whatnot, and he kind of like puts it away because, you know, he's doing his sports book now. He's a made guy. And then he has a little bit of bad luck with a football, with the sports book, with the football bets, and loses a bunch of money somehow. I don't know how bets work. I still don't. Vince, stop trying to explain. And actually, I have a clip from that of when he loses the money due to the football game.
I told you should have fucking laid off some of that action.
Spread's 11. Oregon's down by 12. They're on the 45-yard line with no timeouts.
Oregon's got an all-American fucking field goal kicker.
Why didn't somebody tell me?
See?
USC, that spread could have opened at 18, fucking top 10 team.
So we should have laid off some of the action in Philadelphia. Paulie did it all the time.
You see him here? What's the matter with you people? You deaf? Answer the fucking phones.
So I'm guessing, like, I think when he says we should have laid off some of the action, like, I guess there was people betting heavily one side, and they were like,
we'll take
all those bets. And so they didn't even out, and then they got a...
And maybe spread some of the action over other football games. Again.
Yeah. No, they should have moved the spread so they got more
don't care.
Bets on the other side. I think that's
don't understand.
Reminds me of, because it always reminds me of Silver Linings Playbook.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You're talking about every time I hear anything about betting, I'm like, I think I have like PTS from that scene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I don't understand it.
Or the one, what's Adam Sandler, the Jewel one with Adam Sandler?
Jewel?
The one with Kevin Garnett and Adam Sandler that just came out.
Oh, Uncut Gems.
Uncut Gems, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that. My shoulders are still kind of tense from that movie.
Yeah.
But yeah, so he loses badly. And of course, what an interesting thing is that Paulie, after he welcomes him, hey, you know, you're made now, you get the sports book. Also, you owe me $6,000 a week. And I was kind of expecting that at some point, like, Tony and Paulie would be hanging out and be like, you know, hey, at some point, are you going to stop this prank of having to charge him $6,000 a week? Because that's not tenable at all. Yeah. But that didn't happen, which means, like, how the fuck?
He gave him a whole sports book with the presumption that he'd be making a lot more than $6,000 a week on it.
I mean, I assume so, but I mean, my God, I was just like, I was just thinking about like, it's 2001, $6,000 a week, and I'm just like, I don't
That's
know.
A lot of money.
I don't think I've ever made $6,000 a week in my life.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
I just.
Also, on a side, like, I'm, every time I watch the show, I'm like so deeply conflicted because I'm like, I'm like very much attracted to like Polly. Like, I think
he's yeah?
so hot and like, these people who just in normal world I probably wouldn't be drawn to, but like Polly splayed out in his socks, like very into that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I like the silver wingtips that he's got. Those are nice.
What
also,
does he tell Christopher? He says, "Pop the cuffs," or what does he say? What does he say?
He tells him to pop his cuffs. Yeah, something like that.
Polly fucks.
Polly fucks.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, he's the dude isn't, you know, he isn't getting yoked for no reason, you know. that dude, he's got some guns, and he's like, I have no idea how old Polly is, and that's one of the weird things also with this show. It's like he's kind of like timeless and ageless. Like you assume that he's 60 because
like
look at him.
I think.
But right, he's probably 42. He just tans a lot.
Yeah.
These guys had no skincare regimen at all, other than like, you know,
the
just
brush
put.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Plus, he's, you know, he's eating heavy meat sauce, you know, like four or five times a week, which you shouldn't do. A
lot of meat sauce, and they baste themselves in oil right before they go tanning. I mean, these guys are gonna get melanomas.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, you got to be careful out there. So Chris has to go chase the extra money that he owes Paulie now because he's short, and it all leads to him eventually robbing a Jewel concert, which I think deserves for me to play the sting for my favorite segment. It's the 90s.
It's the 90s. Parents are supposed to discuss sex with their children. It's the 90s. It's the 90s. 90s.
Hell yeah. So in terms of the 90s-ness of this episode, I gotta say, robbing a Jewel concert in scream masks tops the list.
Yeah. Well, there's also AJ's like Slipknot. Slipknot windbreaker and coal chamber jacket.
Oh my God. Coal chamber.
Yeah. I mean, everything about every time AJ's on screen, it's the 90s. That's the feeling I get. But I was just like, I was shocked by the 90s-ness of like Jewel scream masks. I was just like, wow.
I mean, which brings us to our other point of trivia is the fact that the guy selling tickets to the Jewel benefit is Perez Hilton. And it took me a second. I was like, why do I know that guy's face?
Yeah.
And then I looked up the Wikipedia for the episode and he's not in there, but then I had to like Google Perez Hilton Sopranos and to confirm my suspicions that it actually was him.
So you suspected it was him?
Yeah, I recognized his face.
And Carey, did you know that was Perez Hilton?
Yeah, I knew immediately. I thought at first it was going to be like he just is in the background, but when he started confronting them, I was like, oh, he's like having a moment. Like,
so did you know he was in the episode before you watched the episode? Or
no, I didn't. The only one I knew really was because Lady Gaga is in one of the episodes. So that's like
really?
Yeah, she's like on the bleachers during they're like partying at the school pool.
Oh, shit.
Like with one of Meadow's friends.
I'm telling you, the amount of
if you saw her face, you'd be like, well, that is an Italian that should be in one of these episodes.
Yeah.
She is very naturally Italian.
But for me, I'm a huge Lady Gaga fan, and she and Perez had a famous feud.
Really?
To him, her calling the police on him because he moved into her building and she was trying to get like a restraining order on him, I think.
Jesus Christ.
But I love that they both had their start.
Such like a perfect East Coast feud between you know, an Italian from Jersey and a Cuban from Florida who've both changed their names to shed their ethnicity.
Right?
Wait, so Perez Hilton is Cuban?
Yeah.
Oh, I did not know that. I did not know.
Also, a terrible person.
Yeah, no, he's he was the worst. He seems like a kind of like a peak scumbag, but he's like one of those people that I don't really know too much about, other than like he was like, what if I was just TMZ? And
yeah, the only thing you really need to remember about him is he drew like cum dripping from people's mouths. Like,
yeah, that's right. That's right.
But yeah, he was very much like an important figure of that time. Like he really started, yeah, like online.
Oh yeah.
Like, he was like the original shit poster.
I mean, like as someone who like basically ran a blog in the aughts, you know, Perez Hilton was like the most famous person doing that. And it was always kind of like, and if you read any of his stuff, you're like, why are people fucking reading this? Like, it's not like the writing is bad, and it's just very like sixth grade burn book type shit.
Yeah. But the actually great shit poster who still posts is D-listed.
Mm-hmm.
And he also does celebrity news, but he's an amazing writer and he like creates characters. So he, you know, talent it has longevity.
Yeah. Cream rises. The cream rises to the top.
Do you think Perez Hilton's still rich, or is that like, or did it run out? Has he moved on?
I don't know. I think he still has the web. I think people still read it, but I think he's so, I don't know. I remember one time seeing him at a, like twice in like a week at like gay bars in New York. And I was just like, I need to not go out for a while.
I'm just going to wait this out. I'm going to wait this out, and eventually I'll be able to go and he will not be there.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. That does sound like a nightmare. It's funny. I actually, I get him and the fat Jewish mixed up. Just kind of
Gems.
What's that? Oh, he wasn't on
Gems. So I'm telling you.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah. Which one Sopranos of them fucked Jerry, though? That's what I want to know.
Ah, hey. Yes. We're having fun here. Yes. Hey, stupid. Stunad. Yeah. So, I guess the most important storyline, if you count Tony as being an important character, which I do, is the fact that he finally has a therapeutic breakthrough with Melfi.
Could we just not with all the fucking therapy in this show?
Hey, listen, the therapy is the show, all right?
No, it's like
it's analyzed
part
this,
of the pitch, but it's like, serious. All right, we've outgrown this pitch. We don't need to do the goddamn psychoanalysis every episode.
That's true, but I do feel like they started balancing it a little bit. And I thought this episode was a good example of that balance where he goes and, you know, threatens her again, like, I'm going to leave if I don't stop fainting. And then she tries to explain, you know, kind of like the connection with meat.
She's like, no, you're Marcel Proust.
Yeah. And I felt like, what I love about Tony in therapy is the fact that he's just kind of a dumb guy. he's a dum-dum in therapy. And I feel like Melfi forgets that. Either she forgets
it. She doesn't forget that. She's just Meadow. She's a grown-up Meadow where she likes to rub references in his face.
Yeah, and so I do have a clip from that, Vince. It's called Proust.
Mm.
That's why you short-circuited puberty. Witnessing not only your mother and father's sexuality, but also the violence and blood so closely connected to the food you were about to eat. And also the thought that someday you might be called upon to bring home the bacon, like your father.
All this from a slice of gabbagool.
Kind of like Proust's Madeleines. He took a bite of a Madeleine, and that one bite unleashed a tide of memories of his childhood and ultimately of his entire life.
This sounds very gay. I hope you're not saying that.
He's just the dumbest man, and he cannot help himself, but he's thick. And it's one of the things that I enjoy about kind of the therapy scenes progressing as the show goes on,
is like they kind of stop the whole thing. Like, we're going to connect everything to therapy. Every episode will be connected to therapy in some way. And like, you know, he's going to kind of become new agey. Like, they kind of like hinted that a little bit, but he just isn't smart enough. And I like that they, you know, that he can't hear an explanation of Proust without being like, this all sounds kind of gay to me. Like,
yeah, it's like he can't, even if he's like close to maybe elevating himself a little,
yes,
he like, that's gay. Like, that's, that could make him like less of a man.
Right. Yeah. Right. He worries about it emasculating him in some way.
I mean, that's like, the entire premise of Queer Eye is that self-improvement is gay.
That's true.
I but, also just had a flat, like, just, I still can't believe that was like, I mean, as a gay man, like, I, you know, I still remember it. And like, I said it too, but like, how gay was just thrown around so much. Like,
oh yeah.
It's great. Like, I'm so, and it's almost kind of funny in a way. Like, I can look back on it and be like that was normal in 2001. Just be like, you're gay.
Oh yeah, for sure. You know? Although I think I'm wondering, like, Tony sounds like he's being literal there, where he's like,
he's being literal. I'm just thinking of like that time.
Oh, in general. Yes. Yeah. It was just what you said, and it was shorthand every time. Yeah.
He's like very much like, his sexuality is always very like, something's going on.
Well, they, but, yeah, they're like, everything's gay to them. Like, Proust is gay. Going to therapy is gay. Eating pussy is gay for some reason.
Yeah. Like, yeah. They make a lot of connections, to their masculinity that, is just very confusing. like some things have nothing to do with your sexuality or masculinity, but they want to be extra sure. And I do feel like Tony was like earnestly checking in. You're not saying I'm gay, right?
Yeah.
Like, he's like, just as long as you're not saying that. But yeah, he definitely like has sort of a meat based breakthrough in this episode, which I appreciated because of the fact that you know, it's something he can relate to. You know, it's like, if he's gonna kind of like get to the root causes of his panic attacks, I'm glad it's on his terms, on like the terms he can understand. Like, if I see meat, sometimes I faint. Like, yeah. I like the simplicity of that, and yeah.
And she was, you could tell she was excited that she, it was like, oh, I can explain this really well to him.
Yeah, no, she like, was. Like,
oh, I know, Proust.
Yeah.
He'll love this.
He'll love this.
All right. And yeah, I mean, all in all, the episode ends with Jackie Jr. pissing himself and, Chrissy realizing being made isn't all that it's made out to be. Pardon the fun. AJ is sad and confused about his future. He's obviously feeling down on himself. So, you know, hopefully in the next few episodes, he'll get a little pick-me-up. Maybe get a little bit of his confidence back. Mm-hmm. But we'll have to wait and see. Real quick, the last few sections. First, let's talk about who the real gangsta of the episode was. I'm going to say the subconscious. Vince, who's the real gangsta?
I would say pyramid schemes. Like, they've definitely structured the mob like a pyramid scheme where everybody's got to kick up. Pyramid schemes are the real gangsta.
Carey, what do you think the real gangsta of this episode was, as opposed to the mafia?
Svetlana's leg. Like, that was just like insane to me.
Yeah. Janice is definitely
Janice swiping her leg was just
For sure. Yeah, Janice, she truly is the real gangster.
That is definitely the most gangster move of this episode, like, bar none.
Yeah, yeah. Now, you've got to be a fucking stone cold gangster to be like, now you got one leg, bitch. Give me the musical theater back.
Camelot vinyl. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, real quick, gabbagool. This is where we just go over some Italian American slang that we learned in this episode.
So interesting. So here, when Tony says, "What's Jackie Jr. hanging out with that mortadel?" I didn't get that because, like, to me, like, the only thing that I know about mortadel is like that means like mortadella, and so I don't know if that's like an insult to call someone like a cured meat somehow.
Oh.
I don't know. That's all I could come up with. I couldn't find. I tried to Google it. I didn't come up with any good answers there.
Well, if you know,
it's like a writer's room, like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you got to call him something Italian. There's just one of the consultants be like, call him a mortadel.
Yeah.
Trust me.
And then another one, what's his name? Polly tells Christopher, don't give me the maloika, which that's the
maloika. That's the evil eye.
Evil eye, the actual, it's like a bastardization of mal occhio. Which, you know, occhio is Italian for
mal as in bad, yeah. Occhio as an eye.
Yeah, and then so actually like the Italian version of an arm and a leg is an eye in the head. So like when you say something costs a lot, it costs un occhio della testa, which means an eye of the head. So like, you know,
oh.
Yeah.
Which that's is interesting.
Weird.
Are you like fully Italian, Vince?
No, I'm half Italian and I only know this because I was like, you know, fucking trying to learn Italian via audio tape.
Okay. Oh, you should try Duolingo.
Yeah, that was not well, you can't do Duolingo when you're on a bike ride, but you know, I never learned this.
That's
from
a good
like
point.
Family or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, but you could do it at home in bed. My girlfriend does, and we are not having sex as much anymore. All right. Yeah, I think that that covers most of this episode. All in all, this season is looking to be pretty good. I'm enjoying it so far.
Solid B plus.
Solid B plus for sure. Carey, where can people find you on the internet?
You can follow me at eCareyO on Twitter and Instagram, and listen to Sexy Unique Podcasts for a weekly dose of reality TV.
Hell yeah. Yeah. From our TV podcast to yours, I say thank you so much for coming on the show.
Really fun.
Yeah. Thanks for being on.
Yeah, that's great.
Frogcast@gmail.com for all your questions, comments, concerns. And also patreon.com/frogcast for our bonus episodes of a different podcast where we talk about movies instead of The Sopranos. So check that out, frogcast@gmail.com. Vince, what is the Google voice number?
415-275-0030.
All right, everyone. Thanks so much for listening. Once again, teespring.com/store/frogcast for all of your merch needs. We got merch now. Hey, you can buy yourself a gun mug. Actually, you can't. I haven't made that yet, but you will. So check it out. That's teespring.com/store/broadcast. Thanks so much for listening. And until next time, don't stop believing.